be faithful. So God, we lift our needs to you, Lord, and ask you for help. God, may you bless this day and bless our hearts with your Spirit and everything you want to say to us this morning. As in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Wow, 90 years. We have been a part of a great work. And as we talked about a couple of weeks ago, we're not the ones who started this work, right? And we were thinking, who is the longest living member of LAMC? Now, is there anybody that's been here for the whole 90 years? No? Okay, what about 80 years? 70?
700.
Yeah. 60. Anyone here 60 years? What about
60?
Oh, here we go. There's Ray. Yeah. All right, Ray Conybeare. So you don't even look a day past 60. So. So Ray, a few things have changed since then.
A couple things.
And we talked about the church being a torch that's being passed on, and the torch has been passed, and we get the privilege now in the 21st century here in 2016 to carry it the next step of the way. And it is only because of our amazing and incredible God. Amen?
Amen.
And that's what we're here for. It's about spreading the good news of Jesus Christ, and it's all about our mighty God. And we started out with something, as Carter said, maybe a little more familiar to the older folks, and then now we have something a little more that our young people or our children will recognize. So we're going to invite you to stand, and boys and girls, I think you know this song from VBS. You can clap your hands this morning if you feel so inclined. Here we go.
There's no greater power than the power of our God. There's no greater power than the power of our God.
Sing it again. There's no greater.
There's no greater power than the power of our God. There's no greater power than the power of our God. I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas above and filled the lofty skies. I sing
Lord, we thank you. We thank you so much, Jesus, because your love endures forever. And that is the reason that we're here. And Lord, you have been so faithful to us, and we want to say thank you. We thank you that forever your love endures. We want to give thanks this morning for all God has done, and all that he's doing, and all that he will do.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever.
So faithful. And Jesus, you are the King of all. You are the King of our lives personally, and Jesus, you are the King of our church. And in honor of 90 years, God, we want to crown you with many crowns. In honor of your grace and your mercy and salvation that has saved us and set us free. Lord, we don't crown you because of the things that you have done. We crown you because you are just God, and you are amazing, and you're awesome. And so as we sing this, our King and our Father and our Majesty, receive the praise from your people. Receive our love, receive our worship this morning, we pray in Jesus' name. Worship him this morning as we sing Majesty.
Majesty, Lord above heaven.
out this morning. And
majesty, Lord of all, let every
worship him, Jesus.
Before him fall, the King of Kings. Oh, come adore our God who reigns forevermore.
Forevermore. Boys and girls, come on up. We're going to invite you up for High Voltage. If you're visiting with us this morning, a big welcome. We're so glad that you're here to celebrate with us. Following the service, we have a coffee house set up in the gym, and we want to invite you to come and have some coffee and treats and desserts with us as we celebrate 90 years.
All right, you guys can all stand up. We are going to sing Never Be Shaken now for everybody, so you guys can all come on up here. You can go all around the front here. You guys over here, come on over here on the front. Come on over here.
Don't be shy, you got parents here.
Yeah, these guys over there got to see you.
Yeah.
1:12 says, verse 6 says, surely the righteousness will never be shaken. They will be remembered forever.
Proverbs 12, verse 3 says, a man will not be established by wickedness, but the root of the righteousness will not be shaken. Psalm 16, verse 8 says, I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken.
Psalms 21, verse 7 says, for the king trusts in the Lord, and through the loving kindness of the Most High, he will not be shaken.
Psalm 62, 6 says, he alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken.
All right. Okay, boys and girls, so this month we are starting something new. Can you remember what we learned last month? Can you tell me, Taylor, what did we learn all last month?
What was the word? Courage.
Courage. And you guys had courage to get up here and tell, courage, that's right. Mr. Gowdy always talking. All right, so... Oh, he's not the shy one. All right, guys. So today we are going to start something new. And our thing for the month is a word called honor. And so when we honor people, it's letting others see that you see how valuable they are. And so we thought this month we would honor some people. So I want to ask you guys a couple questions. See if you can answer a couple trivia questions. All right? Okay. Who knows how many kids Pastor Jeff has? Who can tell me how many kids? You know?
Three.
That's his second family. How many in his whole family? Do you know? Anybody know?
Five.
Five? Oh, it's getting closer. This is really messing up my point.
He has seven kids.
He has seven kids. Is that right, Pastor Jeff? He has seven kids. Okay. All right, I have another question for you and see if you remember this. I told you guys this month that at the end of every single one of Pastor Jeff's emails, there is a memory verse that you guys have just learned. What is that memory verse? Oh, who remembers it? Neil, you remember it?
Have I not commanded you to be strong and courageous? For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go.
Neil, can I ask you a question? How many weeks have you been coming to church now?
Two.
Two, yeah. He got right into it. First week he had that memorized. I'm so proud of him, and we're so glad that he's here. All right, I have another question for you. On the night that you come to Jube, this is, you have to come to Jube Station for this one, but on the night you come to Jube Station, sometimes the kids wear something funny to church on a night when they have something called PJ Party. Who can tell me what you wear? Can you answer this one, Lexi? What do you wear?
Pajamas.
You wear what?
PJs.
You wear PJs to church. Why?
Because it's a PJ Party.
And what is PJ Party?
It's where you wear your PJs.
And who is PJ?
Pastor Jeff.
And who teaches PJ Party?
Pastor Jeff.
Yeah? So this is the thing. So our very first award, Pastor Jeff, this is from the LAMC kids. Oh, here, Rochelle, you're going to give this. All right. This is our first honor recipient. This is going to go on our wall of honor we're going to have in the gym. So we're going to take that back from you for a little bit. But anyways, this is, but you can keep it for now. So this is for no, yeah, clap. This is because I've been in children's ministries for like 20 years, and when I go to children's ministry conferences, the thing that I hear all the time from the other children's ministry workers is, I wish my senior pastor would listen to this. I wish he could come. I wish he would get more involved. But you know what? Not only is our senior pastor involved, but our senior pastor teaches the kids. He loves the kids. He knows the kids, and the kids know him, and that is such a blessing, and so we are so thankful for that, so thank you. All right, let's pray, and we're going to go. You guys ready? God, I thank you for this church, and I thank you for the history and the heritage, and that we come on the backs of people that have put in a lot of work and a lot of effort and a lot of prayer to make it what it is. And so as we look around at all these children, we see not only the church of tomorrow, but the church of today. And so we thank you for them, and we just don't take that lightly. We pray that we would honor you by teaching them who you are and how much you love them. And so we just pray for that today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, boys and girls. Great job. Our choir is going to come up again. And we do, if you're a part of our church, you know that we do not see our children as just the church of tomorrow, but they are the church of today. And so we love them, and we just appreciate all of you folks, all your moms and dads, and all of the boys and girls. So we keep praying for them. Great job, everybody. Fantastic. Wow, we have so much to be thankful for, and I think this is just the beginning of something that we hope to see more of, right? And I know that there's there's some of you sitting out there who would love to be involved, and so a big, big thank you, especially to Arlene Bridge and to Madeline Kufsky, who kind of... When we first put the sign-up sheet out there, we thought, oh, okay, we might get, you know, 10 or 15 people, and then we were up to 25 at one point, and so everybody was committed, so that's great. We want to see some younger people come on out next time and take part of that, because it's a wonderful, wonderful thing. And then if you get a chance, we want to invite you to make sure you check out some of the photo albums and the pictures and the stuff that's hanging on the wall in the gym and seeing some of the things from the past. You might even see some faces you're familiar. You might even be in some of those photo albums. So it's really, really interesting and encouraging to see just how things have changed and the people that have gone on into ministry and the videos that we saw the last few weeks. They're still online. You can see them on our website. And just the history of where we have come from and the missionaries that have been sent out from this place, not just afar and abroad officially, but just the people who have gone out and their everyday life being missionaries because of the ministry here at LAMC. And so we're really thrilled and excited about that and being a part of that. And as you know, we are a part of a bigger denomination, the Evangelical Missionary Church of Canada. And this morning, we're very excited and we're privileged to have the president of our denomination, Phil Delceau, who's going to come up and share. And Phil's been around for a little while. He can share a little bit about that and some of his history there and from the very beginning. And so, Phil, we want to welcome you to LAMC as we celebrate.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you. It's good to be back. It's been a while. Last time I was here was another anniversary service. I don't quite remember which one that was, but it's great to be here celebrating the 90th anniversary of what God has been at work doing. Our God is a God who is full of surprises. Everyone who is a farmer here, everyone who's a gardener understands that, because every time you plant a seed, there is a miracle that happens. Amen? And that's what God does. So 1926, who would have imagined that this would be some of the fruit, some of the harvest of what God has been busy doing? It is indeed a great thing to be part of God's family and to be part of a particular tribe that is committed to following Jesus together on mission. That's how we describe what we're about, following Jesus on mission together. That's a nice, simple way of saying it, amen? And so we're really glad to be able to celebrate with you on this day. Last week, I was in Winchester with our Harmony Church celebrating 131 years of gospel ministry. And how things have changed since 1885, and how things have changed since 1926. And it wasn't too long before that that I was in New Sarepta, which is just outside of Edmonton, and they were celebrating their 100th anniversary. And the remarkable thing is that there's a great commonality. And you know what the commonality is? A living faith in Jesus. A living faith in Jesus. And I hope we will always include the phrase, the words in Jesus when we say, my faith sustains me. No, everyone has faith. Even an atheist has faith. Atheists believe certain things. They just happen to be wrong. But it is our faith in Jesus, because he's the one who makes the difference. It's the one that we celebrate. It's all about Jesus. We call this a Christian church because of Jesus Christ. Amen? And we are here because we understand that there are many voices that want to interpret reality for us. And we are here because we understand that there is only one voice that really makes sense of all that we experience. So it was a great thing, Pastor Jeff, to see all the children here. And I'm so glad that they love you and that you love them. And that God is using the ministry of this community, because that's what you are. And sometimes we use church in a way that doesn't really help us. So I use the word community, or to describe the church, I say the people of God in Christ. That's who we are, the people of God in Christ. And it is a good thing when you have someone who's only been here 2 weeks who begins to embrace the Word of God because of the people of God who have been busy sharing the vitality of their own life in Jesus. Now, I want to bring greetings from churches that extend all the way from Richmond in British Columbia to Halifax in Nova Scotia. That's our newest work. It is a church that is being planted, a congregation that is being planted by those who have a vision to see Jesus making a difference in the lives of people in Halifax. And I think they call themselves Haligonians. And they are taking a wonderful approach because, you see, they recognize that in order to be heard, what they need to do is to walk with people, to live their lives in front of people. In fact, this is not something new. This is something which is profoundly biblical. And so we know that we are living in different times, and we don't have the same kind of standing. And that's where I believe that listening to the words of 1 Peter are so important, because this is how we get heard. Not by standing up and saying prophetically, return, because most of the people in Canada have nothing to return to. They need to come for the first time. And so hear these words, and please take note, because this is a tract for our times. And here it is, 1 Peter 2:11. Dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world. That's how Peter talks about us as followers of Jesus. We are aliens and strangers. We are exiles, if you will, to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. Live such good lives. Did you hear that? Live such good lives among the pagans, that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. Now, you know how believers in our day get accused. So this fits, doesn't it? And what's the thing that makes the difference? It's how we live our lives. Now, this passage flows through, and then a verse that we quote very often, which is in chapter 3, and this is down in verse 15, we read these words, that, but in your heart set apart Christ as Lord, always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you, to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. And you see, people do come and ask you, what makes you different? Amen? They ask, why are you doing this? They want to know, what is it? And we are living in a world that is actually hungry for the things of Jesus. And we have sometimes been remiss because we have, in fact, hidden our light under the bushel basket. And the way in which we do this is all the way back in verse 11 or 12 of 1 Peter 2. Live such good lives. People take notice of this. Amen? You know that this is so. And so sometimes we say, we want you to be a witness. Pastor Jeff, have you tried that? And what kind of responses do you get when you say, I want you to witness this week? Guilt, fear. But let me say, we are called, first of all, to bless, to live such good lives. Now, I'm not going to take you through all the verses, but you'll see over and over again throughout these verses that you find bless, do good, love, over and over again in these words, because that's how we are to live. And you see, I'm going to ask you, can you bless someone this week? Yes. Can you do good? In fact, I saw a school that had on their talking sign, this is doing random acts of kindness week. Well, now, where in the world did that idea come from? It comes from Jesus. A little while ago, I was in India and with our partner. By the way, is this message taped? You know, okay. I'll be careful how I phrase it, because I don't want to get our partner in India in trouble, because you understand that there are some very active forces that actually bring violence against our partner in India. But I'll speak in a little more general terms, and if some of you want to ask me more detail, you can. But I was asked to speak, and so there is a movement of about now 3 million believers in northern India, which has been called the graveyard of the missionary, and God is doing something absolutely extraordinary there. And it has grown out of a university that was started as a Bible school originally in 1910 by a Presbyterian missionary that had kind of drifted away from the gospel, and in the last 15 years has come back to the gospel under the leadership of a new vice chancellor. And a vice chancellor is like a university president on steroids. He's got extraordinary powers. But in any case, he came to the Lord, and he began to preach, and God has done an extraordinary thing through this ministry. This particular school has now grown to nearly 15,000. It has university status, but as a Christian minority institution, and in fact, it is applying for state university status, which would be a first in a country of 1.2 billion people. Did you hear that? 1.2 billion people. And so God is doing something absolutely extraordinary there. During one of my visits, I was asked if I would address their education department. And so they had a room full of all the students that were studying to either go into primary school education or secondary or even university education. And in order to get them all there, what they did was they held off the final exam until after I spoke so that they had to come. Talk about a captive audience. And so they were piled into this room, and they had people who were almost sitting on each other's laps because there were so many people. And I was told, be careful how you speak, because there are Hindus and Muslims as well as Christians there. Because even though it is a Christian university, it has an open registration, admission system, and many, many people come, and in large part because it is such a quality place. And so I was wondering, Lord, how am I going to address these good folk? And so I began by asking these prospective teachers, what kind of teacher would you like to have teach your children? Would you want a teacher that you could trust to actually teach or treat your children fairly? And they said, oh, yes, 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 yes. And would you want a teacher that you could trust that would not abuse your children? Oh, yes, yes, yes. And I proceeded to ask questions like that. And then I told them about this wonderful ad that I had seen. This is the whole front page of a newspaper in northern West Bengal, another part of India, in which you had the advertisement of a school. And the advertisement was of this great luscious tree that had the roots, and the roots were all exposed, and on each root was written a word like truth and honesty and hard work and love and kindness and so on. And I said, do you know where all these things grow? Because people everywhere value these things. And I said, the only place that I know where these things, all these things are taught, are in the Bible. And I said, you can choose whatever system you want, but let me tell you, doesn't it make sense to actually embrace a way of looking at the world, a worldview, an ideology that actually encourages and endorses and gives a firm foundation for these things? And in fact, something more. Because you see, we also have the promise of God that if we put our trust in Jesus as our Savior and Lord, He will give us the power to live in this way. And so I commend Jesus to you. And see, and that's the privilege that we have. We are living in a country that values these things. They value love and family and honesty and so on. But what tree do these things grow on? They don't grow on the tree of atheism. Atheism has no place for love or truth or honesty. Now, I'm not saying atheists don't value these things. They do. But what they do is dishonestly, they steal from the tree of biblical values, you see? And so what we need to do is to be clear that we understand where these things come from. And as Peter says, to share these things gently and with respect. And very often we're not heard because it is not with gentleness and respect. Sometimes we're quite strident. And sometimes we're speaking out of fear. But we can speak confidently. Now, you see, what we are doing when we're gathered here and we're listening to the Word of God is we're saying we want the Scriptures to interpret reality for us. And that's so important. There are so many voices out there that are interpreting reality for us. Now, I won't ask you what kind of phone you have in your pocket, but you see, somebody's been pretty busy passing along propaganda so that you will buy a particular phone, true? Or a particular vehicle. We live in a society that is consumer-driven because we have people who are busy telling us the most important thing is the kind of car you drive, the clothes you wear, the phones you have, etc., etc. And we need to pay attention to these things, that we are here because we want the Word of God. We want Jesus to interpret reality for us. And don't think that because you don't come to church, that somehow no voices are there and that you are interpreting reality for yourself. Have you noticed how the same kids who say, I'm my own person, I'm making my own identity, are also the same ones that must wear the same clothes and have the same electronics? And that's because somebody is, in fact, imposing reality on them. So, I haven't even gotten to my message yet. So, Pastor Jeff, tell me how long I've got, by the way. About 2 minutes? Is that what you said?
We're usually out by noon.
You're out by noon. Okay. That's a deal. We'll get you out by noon. Okay? I want you to know that as a family, God has been good to us as a family of churches. That God continues to add to our numbers. So this year we've already brought 4 new congregations into the family because they recognize the value of being part of a family that knows where it's going. And we know where we're going. We are following Jesus on mission together. And this month, during the national board meetings, there will be 2 more that will actually become associate members. So we're thankful for what God continues to do, because there is value in being together. The beginnings of this congregation is because of city mission workers. Now, some of you will know something more about these faithful women of God who would come into a community, would live on next to nothing. But be present just because God had placed them there and the conference had sent them there in order to see the good news of Jesus shared. I want to share one other piece of really good news, and this happens on a scale, on a level that we may not always get, understand or get hold of, but some of you will know about Trinity Western University and the court case. Have you heard about Trinity Western? Okay. November the 1st, just a few days ago, the BC Court of Appeals came out with a very, very positive, strong ruling in favor of Trinity Western University, which is a Christian university. And there are words in there that are worth quoting. There are words in there that give us confidence that we have a place at the table in the public square in Canada. And so let's make sure we stand up and be heard by speaking reasonably, with gentleness and respect, but speaking into things. We have a place. I don't have time to say more about that, but just check out Trinity Western, and there is a 66-page court ruling if you'd like to read a court document. But it is full of good news for religious freedom, for the privilege that we have of gathering, for understanding that we are living in a culture where we can express our faith, not only as individuals, but as communities. And we should say a big amen and praise the Lord to that, I'll tell you. Because this has profound implications to our freedoms here in this country. What I want to talk to you about is where does this ability to live such good lives come from? So now I'm actually bridging to the message, Pastor Jeff, okay? And I don't know if you noticed, but at the beginning of verse 15 in 1 Peter 3, you'll see that he says, "But in your heart set apart Christ as Lord," or the older translation, "sanctify." Now, how do we set apart Christ as Lord in our hearts? And our hearts, by the way, are the very center of our beings, the thing that gives us life itself. Now, if you want to know what's at the center of your heart, check your credit card statement. I was going to say checkbook, but we don't use those things anymore. And check where you spend your time, and that probably describes where your heart is. True? That is true. And the question is, what actually makes your heart beat faster? And you see, Peter says that if you're going to live in this way, you set apart Christ as Lord. In other words, you say, "Jesus, you are the very center of our being." So I want to go to a passage that actually talks about that in very different terms. It's in John chapter 15. So if you want to turn to John chapter 15, we'll have a look at what the Lord Jesus said in his concluding words, because this is the evening before the crucifixion takes place. And this are the words that he had to say to his disciples then. A lot of good things. But chapter 15 is specifically about our intimate life in Jesus. And so in verse 1, he says, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I've spoken to you." And then this phrase, "remain in me, and I will remain in you." Now, I wonder, who knows the phrase, "practicing his presence"? Have you heard that phrase? One, two. Practicing his presence. This is an expression that comes to us from a Benedictine monk, in which he, in his words, Brother Lawrence is his name, You can find it on the internet. It's just a few pages, but it is about living with an awareness of the Lord Jesus. Living continually with an awareness of the Lord Jesus. What I've discovered is that it is not as common as I thought. That among God's people, we don't necessarily live our lives with a continual awareness of the Lord Jesus. Even right now, you may not be very much aware of the Lord Jesus. And that's the remarkable thing, that the scripture says, 1 Thessalonians reminds us, that we are to pray without ceasing, pray continually. The Lord Jesus here says, remain in me. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. And so what I do in my practice is regularly I just keep sending up prayers to Jesus, and I say, Jesus, and then I don't have to say a lot because the thing that I'm engaged in actually provides the information. So I can tell you that even now I'm saying, Lord Jesus, be honored in the things I say, be glorified, so that it isn't about me, it isn't even about the good folk I'm speaking to, but it's about you. And so practicing the presence is at the very center of how we are to live. How intimate is it? Well, go back to verse 1 of this chapter. And here we have the fact. The fact is, Jesus says, I am the true vine, my Father is the gardener, and you are the branches. That's the fact of what our life in Jesus is like. We are branches that receive the life flow from Jesus. Amen? Now, you're not an amen church, I would gather. Well, you've got so many other good things going for you. Become an amen church. Help me along here, okay? The preaching will go better if you actually say amen. Okay? Oh, that's good. It'll also be shorter if you say amen. Amen. And that was a lie. Okay. All right. It might become longer, actually. But you see, we have the fact. Who has the life? Jesus has the life. How do we tap into the life? Well, here we have a command and a privilege. Verse 4, remain in me, remain in me. The easiest way in our generation to get this staying plugged in is, in fact, with electrical cord. Try and run your appliances without it being plugged in, okay? So why are we trying to run our lives in Jesus without being plugged in? What's going to happen? Not much. So stay plugged into Jesus. Set apart Jesus as Lord in your heart. Stay plugged in. And then he says, no branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. So this is the vital relationship. And this has to do with practicing the presence of whatever situation. You know, when that guy cuts you off in traffic and you want to curse, what do you do? Here's what I do. I have an inclination to want to not bless. And I say, Lord Jesus, bless him. That does something for me and it does something for him and it honors Jesus. Amen? Amen. Oh, we're doing a little better. We're getting there. All right. So, we have the fact, verse 1. We have the command, verse 4. Verse 5, we have the power of a transforming friendship. Because here's the remarkable thing, that our Savior and our Lord makes us friends. Makes us friends. So, let me read verse 5 and following. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Now, here he isn't talking about a godly life, that is part of it, but he is talking about the fruit of a follower is another follower, okay? And that's how we impact our world. And then he says, apart from me, you can do
nothing.
Nothing, thank you. Did you hear that? It is nothing, not something, not a little bit, but nothing, okay? Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. Man, you've given me a choice here. Anybody want to make the choice of the latter, being thrown away and burned? No, I want to be alive in Jesus. But sometimes as God's people, we are like that cow that's got caught in the fence because it didn't quite like the grass and it liked the corn on the other side of the fence, and it's got neither. So let's not get stuck on the fence. Let's be firmly rooted, joined at the hip, plugged into Jesus. And so we have the fact, we have the command, we have the power of a transforming friendship, and we have the purpose. And this is found in verse 7. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be given you. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. Now, you know, this verse sometimes gets ripped out of context. But the purpose of being able to pray and ask whatever you want to ask is because we are in fact alive in Jesus and we want to ask those things which bring him glory. And when we pray that way, you will be heard. When it's about yourself, don't expect a good answer. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit. This is a harvest term. So if you plant wheat seed, what do you get? Harvest of wheat. If you plant sorghum, what do you get? Sorghum. And on the list goes. And so the Lord Jesus is saying, when you plant a disciple, what do you get? Another disciple. Not a deeper Christian walk, but another disciple. We are involved in a mission of making disciples who make disciples. And we've gotten away from that. So what wonderful things we do through our programs, praise God, but when you scratch down what you actually discover, it's actually one life influencing another life. It's somebody who knows Jesus who is bringing life to another person in Jesus, amen? So do we actually need the programs? No, we don't. Praise God that we have them, but we have multitude of opportunities once we get out of the mindset that it must be about the program instead of about the relationships that we have, that we bear much fruit, bringing glory to God and showing ourselves to be disciples. And we have an approach to disciple making that we call the way of Jesus. And I hope that eventually you'll understand the value of this and you'll invite or take part in some training opportunities that we're increasingly offering. The second saying, because it's based on seven sayings, the second saying is, I am being sent by Jesus to bless others and to invite them to follow him. Sent is the mission word. And sometimes we don't value blessing as being the mission that we're on. But let me tell you, the gospel is not heard unless those who share it actually practice the gospel. It is the demonstration of the gospel as much as the proclamation of the gospel that is important. I just took my watch off. Pastor Jeff, it's 1:45. I forgot to change. So I've already blown it. But you see, we have been called to bless. That goes back to 1 Peter chapter 2, doesn't it? Live such good lives. Live lives of blessings. Matthew chapter 5, be like your heavenly Father. What does your heavenly Father do? He blesses both the righteous and the unrighteous. He causes the sun to shine on both the righteous and the unrighteous. He causes the rain to fall on both the righteous and the unrighteous. Our God is a God of blessing, and he expects us to be a people of blessing. Live such good lives, rooted in Jesus. I am being sent by Jesus to bless others and to invite them to follow him. So I'll just tell you a story that happened this summer. I try and live a life of blessing every day. And that's where, by the way, practicing the presence really comes in. Because you see, as your conscious Jesus helped me to be a blessing, it makes a huge, huge difference. Anyway, my wife and I were returning from a visit to our daughter in Virginia Beach. And that was, it's about a 14-hour drive with some minor stops. And at this point, coming back, we had been on the road for 3 hours. And we had been averaging 50 kilometers an hour. And the traffic around Washington, D.C. was absolutely horrific. So we stopped at a famous international restaurant for a break, McDonald's. And and it is, you know, 36, 37 degrees. And as I'm walking towards the restaurant, a young man stops me and says, "Excuse me, sir, could you help me boost my car?" So I'm already behind schedule at this point, Pastor Jeff, so what do you think I said? I said, "Sure." But I'm also praying, "Lord Jesus, help." Because I really don't want to do it. It's hot. We got a long way to go. We got 600 miles. I don't know what it is in kilometers. Figure it out. Because we've only been averaging, as I say, we've only traveled about 100 miles at this point. And so I pull my car in beside, and we hook up the cables, and 20 minutes later, he still can't get it juiced. And so I said, "Well, you talked about buying a new battery. How about if we go and get you a new battery?" So, all right, he wanted to buy it at Walmart, so now find a Walmart. And neither of us are anywhere near wherever we are. We end up going to the Walmart. My wife stays behind with the young mom who had a 3-month-old baby, and they're waiting there, and my wife comes up to me and she says, "They're gonna need a little help." So it means I'm buying the battery. That's what it means. I am being sent by Jesus to bless others. That's what's going through my head, friends. And I say, "Lord Jesus, help." So we get in the vehicle, this young fellow and myself, and away we go. And as I'm going, I'm wanting to share about Jesus, you see. And already he's already saying, I don't understand why you're doing this, because we've already spent about a half an hour or so with these good folk. And so I say, "Well, you know, when we moved to Elmira, one of the men of the church, his name's Shelley Militzer, some of you may know Shelley Militzer, when he was a young man, was walking with a heavy load to the neighboring community of Conestoga. And as he was laboring under this load, there was an old order Mennonite fella in his wagon that was coming the other way. And this old order fella stopped and said, 'Where are you going?' And he said, 'Conestoga.' The old order fella turns his wagon around and says, 'Put your load on,' and took him into Conestoga. And he said these words to Shelley, 'We're put on this earth to help one another.'" Now, that made a huge impression on Shelley. It made a huge impression on me when Shelley told me. And I told this young fella that this. And then I told him a couple of our travel stories of how God had intervened. Once when we were stranded coming from Northern Ontario, where I was pastor for 6 years, and being stranded in the middle of nowhere, and I had a particular brand of vehicle that was notorious for electrical problems. You can ask me privately what brand of vehicle that was. And of course, I carry two cans of spray, one to dry and one to coach. And this night, it wasn't working. And I could see yard lights that were off in the far distance, and I knew we were surrounded by lakes, and it was a sleety, rainy night. It was an awful night, and I had my wife, and I, at that point, we only had three children in the car. By the way, you had three right answers here, right? Because you do have three, you do have five, but you also have seven, right? And so I'm thinking, it's not a good thing for me to set out. And there were no other vehicles. There had been no other vehicles for quite some time. And so I got back into the driver's seat, and I said to Michelle, my wife, I said, let's pray. And you want to know what prayer I prayed? Because this is a prayer that you should use. And I suspect it's a prayer you've used, Art, once or twice. Lord, help. That was all. We opened our eyes, and as we opened our eyes, there was a Ford van, I'll tell you that, a Ford van that pulled in right in front of us. I got out, talked to the fella, showed him the wonderful blue electrical arc, you know, when the thing's shorting out. And I said, the coil wire, it keeps shorting out. So he said, just a minute. He walks back to the door of the van, comes back, and he comes back with a coil wire. We plug it in, and away it went. And I never had to replace that for the life of the vehicle thereafter, until my son was involved in an accident in Kitchener where he was T-boned. Anyway, but you see, that was God's provision, you see? So I told him that story, told young Dennis that story. Then I told him another story. This was a battery story. And I won't tell you the whole thing except to say that we were now in Wisconsin. There was incredible heat from under the hood. I look under the hood, and there's my battery, and it looks like a basketball. It was so swollen, it hadn't burst. And so we sat there for a little while to let it cool down, and I said, Lord, what are we going to do? Because, again, we weren't in a really populous area. Well, within 5 minutes of getting back on the interstate, we came to one of these interstate battery places that was right there along the interstate. And so, you know what the young man said? Wow, God works in mysterious ways. So do you think he was interested in hearing about Jesus? He sure was. And so before we left, I shared with him the little card that we have that has the seven sayings. And I say, this is all that we were doing. We were trying to live out, I am being sent by Jesus to bless others and to invite them to follow him, you see. And so this brings up the truth that the only way in which we experience the actual power and presence of God is in loving obedience, and that we actually find in this chapter. As we read verse 9, as your Father has loved me. See how he has moved from talking about remaining in him to love. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. Now, did we express love to this young family? We sure did. But not because it was convenient, not because I wanted to, not because I liked them or didn't like them, I didn't know them. But because I love Jesus. Because I love Jesus. If you obey my commands, I will. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, he says. Did you hear that? Was I being obedient to Jesus? I was then. I'm not always, but I was then. Was I experiencing the love of God? Yes, I was. Was I sharing the love of God? Yes, I was. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. And you see, it's Lord Jesus saying, I'm not asking you to do anything that I don't do. Okay? So are we following Jesus or are we not? Are we going to be like him or are we not? I have told you this so that my joy in you may be complete. What a wonderful thing. He brings joy into our lives. Do you think we went on our way rejoicing even though we got home 4 hours late? We sure did. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Now, this has always been the mark of the follower of Jesus, love. And love is an action word. It goes beyond like. It means that you can even love those whom you may not like. And you know, I've been married now 42 years, Pastor Jeff, and let me confess, I don't always like my wife. And the truth is, she doesn't always like me either. Why are you laughing? You know it's true. Okay? But love goes beyond that. Love is where you are doing what is best for somebody. Even when they're doing wrong, you want to do what's best. It doesn't mean that you simply go along with them. It doesn't just mean that you're emotionally connected. It's something more than that. It's doing what is good and what is right for them. With compassion, of course, with warmth. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You are my friends. You are my friends. Did you hear that? That's what he's saying to us. There's an if. He says, you are my friends if you do what I command. Now, does that make sense? Is this conditional? No, it isn't conditional. We've got five children, and periodically my children would come up and particularly express, Dad, I love you, I love you. I say, yeah, that's wonderful. But what does love mean when I tell you to do something and you aren't doing it? Are you showing love to me? And Pastor Jeff, do you ever say things like that to your kids? Yeah. Because you see, there is a relation between our words, our emotional warmth, and our willingness to actually do something that shows blessing. And how do you relate to those who have authority? And the way you do that, how you relate to your parents, if you show love to them, is you listen to them because they have been placed in a place of authority. But Jesus says, you are friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I've called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I've made known to you. So here we're getting divine guidance for our lives. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit that will last. The reason that this congregation is still here is because we've had generation upon generation that have been planting fruit that will last. Fruit that will last. Then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. This is my command: love each other. Let's understand that this is rooted in a living relationship with Jesus, one in which we stay plugged in to Jesus. And this is where I'm going to encourage you to practice the presence. And I have learned that we as followers of Jesus need to learn to practice the presence. You may say, well, what a strange thing. If I have a relationship with Jesus, do I really need to practice the presence? And I'm almost done, Pastor Jeff, even though it is 1 o'clock on my watch. there's the little anecdote about the husband and the wife, and you understand that this was some time ago because they were sitting on the front seat of their car, and it had a bench seat. Anybody remember bench seats in the front? And do you remember how the guy would sit behind the steering wheel and the sweetheart would sit right up close beside? And you remember that? Yeah, okay, you remember that. Okay. You got any stories to tell? Okay. We won't ask them right now. And so this is a husband and wife, 20 years in, and she's sitting over by the passenger's door, and she says, you know, honey, you remember how we sit? We used to sit so close together. I miss that. Whatever happened? And the husband is sitting behind the steering wheel, and he says, I haven't moved. And you know, we can be in the same room and be very, very far away. And we can always be living in the presence of God and be very, very far away. And that's why I'm encouraging this morning to practice His presence, to let the reality of Jesus be a very palpable, a very significant reality. And yes, it does take practice. It does take intentionality. The third expression, third saying in our training is, I am learning to be like Jesus in my attitudes, behaviors, and character. And let me tell you, I go over that regularly from first thing in the morning because I wake up grumpy. And that's not my wife. And I say, he who laughs last just caught on. Okay. And as soon as I pray that, I pray, Lord, help. Lord, help. Anyway, it's been good to be with you. Your future is directly tied to this truth. Remain in Jesus. Remain in His love. Learn to practice His presence. And for those of you who are not very far along in this journey, begin to discover it and practice it and discover how much of a difference it makes in your life every moment of every day. God bless you. Let's pray together. Thanks again, O Lord, for your goodness to us. Thanks again, O Lord, that you have called us friends and that as our friend, you have made the supreme sacrifice. You indeed have laid down your life for us. We're thankful that love, O Lord, is something that you have particularly revealed and made known to us through your own person. And thanks, O Lord, for how you have infected us in such a wonderful way. For we have experienced so much of your love through your people. And Lord, all that we would ask is that as we look forward, that we would understand that you have been good to us in the past, but the past is past and the future is open. And you have determined that you will bless us and continue to bless us and make us a blessing. And the only thing we need is to remain in you, and you will remain in us. Thank you for hearing us, because we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Phil. Let's stand together. And this song is our prayer as we close off our time together.